I will present the best evidence of substance, only the best and sweetest of butter, that suggests Wonderland and the Looking Glass can teach children Aristotle's 10 logical categories, from lowest to highest, the way a passionate child would look upwards to adults of substance, and that the Snark Hut, following Alice's adventures, is likely a logic problem, like those Carroll posed in his works on logic, and solved by finding a category of Aristotle and assigning one of the 10 to each of the 10 hunters. First, the 10 logical categories. The central idea of Aristotle's first book on logic, those 10 categories in the order Aristotle himself lists them, but backwards, as if in a mirror, fit the order of events and characters of both books, chapter by chapter. In the text, he lists 10 different things we can say about things. Substance, the material being of this or that thing. Quantity, the number or amount of a thing. Quality, an aspect of a thing, such as good or green. Relations, the interaction of a thing with others. Space, the place a thing is in and occupies. Time, the duration of a thing and the things it involves. Position, the situation of a thing with other things. State, the current status of a thing in terms of itself. Action, what a thing does to itself or other things. And passion, what moves a thing to this or that action. Aristotle discusses substance first, the basis of truth and being itself, and proceeds only somewhat in his own stated order to illustrate many but not all of the 10, leaving the last few, including lowly passion, largely unillustrated. It may be Carroll found further illustrations necessary and put them in the hands of children. If we turn Aristotle's own list of categories backwards, we have passion, action, state, position, time, space, relations, quality, quantity, and substance. And this inverted list fits the order of events and characters Alice encounters in both of her adventures, with the two books mirroring each other, chapter by chapter. In Wonderland, the first adventure, fitted to Aristotle's inverted list. The white rabbit is passion, the mouse is action, the dodo is state, the rabbit's house is position, the caterpillar is time, the Cheshire cat is space, the duchess is relations, the mad tea party is quality, the queen's garden is quantity, and the king's trial is substance. As Wonderland opens, Alice is full of passion but frustrated in many ways. Bored, as she wants to join in something with her sister, but uninterested in a book without pictures or conversations. She considers weaving a white daisy chain as the white rabbit runs by, worried and late. Passion bonds us, and Aristotle said we share passion with beasts, but we use language and logic, which is why Alice is amazed by the rabbit. Alice follows, burning with curiosity, without a thought of how to get back. The hole dips, and she falls in without time to think, as she is so passionate. As she falls, Alice worries about killing someone below, worries what opposite others will think, and worries her cat will miss her. Many worries, many passions. Alice thinks of Dinah, her cat, asks herself if cats eat bats, and then if bats eat cats. Alice follows a rabbit into a frustrating hall of locked doors and can't solve the problem of the golden key, which sits on a three-legged table, like the golden goal of ethics balanced on a syllogistic three-legged logic. She cries and demands she stop crying this minute, with no patience for herself and too passionate to follow her own advice. In the next chapter, Alice struggles with action in many ways as she meets the mouse. She considers the useless action of sending Christmas presents to her feet. She can't remember who she is, so she tries to act as others can't, but instead of reciting a piece about a busy bee, the poem warps into a crocodile welcoming fish swimming into its jaws. She falls into her tears, enveloped further by her passion, but she sees a mouse swimming in her own hopeless situation and speaks to him of cats and dogs, expressing her passion but not thinking of his, so he reacts and swims away. They agree to swim to shore together, joined by many others who follow their actions, swimming in their wake. In the next chapter, we are told in the first words, reaching a steady state on the shore, the party assembles, and Alice feels she has known them all her life. The mouse tells a dry tale about William the Conqueror, the original state patriarch of England. Alice isn't dried by the stately story, and the dodo solemnly moves to adjourn the meeting and adopt another motion. They run the caucus race. The dodo decrees everyone has won, and all get prizes Alice has to pay for out of pocket. The dodo thimbolically, gives her a thimble. Adding death to taxes, the mouse then recites a poem about a dog who is judge, jury, and executioner, all the positions of state justice, to explain why he fears larger creatures. Alice frightens the animals off, but some make polite excuses. In the next chapter, the rabbit returns, still worried about the superiors of higher position and mistakes Alice for his subordinate servant Mary Ann, ordering her into his house to fetch his things. She accepts the order and fills his entire house, occupying the entire position available. Aristotle's examples of position include sitting and lying down. He says you can't contradictorily do both at once, but if you look at the image of Alice in there, she seems to be doing both at once uncomfortably. Alice considers how much her position has changed, and thinks her story should be put in a book, the position she is in for us. The rabbit calls for Bill the Lizard, his lowly servant digging for apples, trying to find something of value in too low a place, just like his master does with him, as Bill fails to eject Alice after they position him on top of the house with ladders lashed together. Alice says she wouldn't want to be in Bill's position, shrinks and runs into the woods, where she finds herself in the opposite position, scared of a monstrous happy puppy. She looks above the mushroom, higher than her in position, and finds the caterpillar. In the first words of the next chapter, the caterpillar and Alice look at each other for some time in silence. He asks her who she is, and she says she knew this morning but has changed so much since then. The caterpillar asks again who she is and circles back to where they started, like the hookah and smoke circling over his head. He asks her to return and keep her temper. She swallows her anger and waits several minutes for him to speak, and he asks her to speak instead, treading more on her patience, and to recite Old Father William, a poem about an elder who says he looked to the future and gives wisdom to the young. But Alice's father William is a fat fool who stands on his head, argues with his wife, balances eels on his nose, and tries to sell the youth medicinal oils, which shows he has learned nothing over the course of his life. The caterpillar tells her it is wrong from beginning to end, its entire duration. Alice waits patiently for him to say something as he leaves, and the caterpillar rewards her with the mushroom. Alice meets an impatient pigeon who attacks her, defends its young, and has no time to hatch eggs, wait for serpents, and get sleep, since the highest tree in the woods is not safe. The pigeon is impatient. Alice, patient with the pigeon, says she is young too, but eats eggs, and the pigeon makes the hasty, untempered judgment that little girls are some kind of serpent, and has no time, she says, to further relate to or feel for little girls. In the next chapter, after the break, Alice watches space get intertangled in relations as the queen's fish footman from the larger sea tangles wigs with the Dutch frog footman of the smaller pond. Inside the house is immediately the Cheshire Cat. The Duchess is abusive and neglectful, in charge, but she is terrible at relations. The Cat and Duchess share the same chapter without speaking to each other. The sharp-chinned Duchess is divisive, thinks her baby sneezes to displease her, and gives no glance to the cook, who fills her house with pepper and throws everything but the sink. Later, the Duchess fears the Queen but boxes her ears and gets arrested. In the categories, discussing relations, Aristotle says beauty might not be endlessly relative, as something could exist that nothing is uglier. Unfortunately, the illustration of the Duchess is just such a portrait. When Alice takes the baby outside, it turns into an ugly pig, which Alice finds hideous, and then she reacts to it by abandoning the pig in the woods. Here, still in the same chapter, the Cheshire Cat appears in a tree, enticing and intimidating. The side Alice loves and the side the mouse fears together, like a baby or pig depending on which branch we sit. The cat cares as little where Alice goes in space as the caterpillar cares about how much she changes in time, and both have lessons for Alice, patience and perspective. At Oxford, Carroll missed his family in Cheshire, so some part of him was there while the rest of him was elsewhere. The cat translocates without moving and partially appears, just as we see only part of space at any given time. In the illustration of the cat's head grinning above the argument in the Queen's garden, he seems both figure and ground, the overall and particular positions. The cat implies we are all insane to others who face or go the opposite way. He vanishes but returns twice, first to ask what happened to the baby, and then to ask if Alice said pig or fig, which shows he is forgetful. He's master of space but not time. Next chapter, Aristotle's examples of poor quality are rudeness and madness. They're both on full display at the Mad Tea Party. The Heron Hatter lean on the Dormouse as he sleeps, tell Alice there is no room for her at the table, and return her insistence with rude remarks, the Hare uncivilly offering her non-existent wine, and the Hatter suggesting a haircut, which Alice says is too personal. The Hatter asks her a riddle with no answer, and the party baselessly claim Alice doesn't say what she means, with each substitution further from what she meant in the particular moment. The Hare uses the best butter, which doesn't matter, because the Hatter's watch is still broken, as the best in quality isn't best if poorly used. Time stands still for both of them, so neither can grow and improve. The Hatter says perhaps Alice hasn't spoken to time, but she has. If the caterpillar himself is time, and none of them would know it. The party doesn't consider the future when they're fully around the table, and would rather listen to a Dormouse's story about sisters who are sick and stuck in a well, which is similar to their own position. Alice leaves what what she says is the stupidest, worst tea party ever, poorest in quality, is her final words. Next chapter, she finds in the garden not Eden through this, but quantities. Numbered playing cards, painting white roses red. The 2, 5, and 7 of spades, and they fall on their faces as the rest of the pack march by in pairs, followed by royalty, all in order. Neither the queen nor knave know who Alice is, and she has neither number nor class. Alice reassures herself they're all merely symbolic. Carroll and other logicians of his day were seeking rules and foundations for mathematics and logic, like a lawless croquet game where the equipment doesn't behave and there are no orderly turns. Alice thinks of escaping the place, and the Cheshire Cat appears. He asks her how she is getting on. In discussing relations, Aristotle says some animals have no heads, and again the Cheshire Cat entirely contradicts Aristotle with his example. At this point in the next chapter, there should be substance, but Alice and the Duchess trade false morals and meet two liars who lack substance, the Griffin, a myth, and the Mock Turtle. The Griffin tells Alice the fake turtle's tears are all an act, but then joins in his story and both pretend to sob. The Mock Turtle speaks in a deep, hollow tone, and when Alice points out a tortoise couldn't teach in the sea, the Griffin shames her. The Mock Turtle says they studied ambition, distraction, uglification, and derision, and the pair use all four on Alice. The pair dance the lobster quadrille, shout and scream with delight, then drop the passion suddenly, showing it's all an act. Alice tells the two her story so far, and they interrupt at old Father William, as curious and backwards as could be to them, because they say what they don't mean, while Alice didn't say what she meant to say. Alice tries to recite another poem, but speaks of a lobster who talks when the tide is low, but changes his tune when the tide is high. The Mock Turtle sings of beautiful soup we should buy with no description of what substance goes into it, which sounds like false advertising. The Griffin takes Alice to the King of Hearts court trial of who stole the sweet substance of tarts. The King includes all useful and useless evidence and testimony. Alice identifies the King by his wig, which he wears over his crown, one substance sitting uncomfortably on another. Alice says they haven't had any solid substantive evidence or testimony yet and is called to the stand as she grows into the largest substance in the room. The rabbit interrupts with a poem of empty direct references, form empty of content, and the King fills it with content and substance, foolishly fitting individuals from his court trial into the form. They're all a pack of cards, and ends the trial and her dream.